The court is really interested in its legitimacy, its neutrality, the fact that what it does is law, not politics. A lot of people don't think that's what it does, but they need for it to look like they do law, not politics. And so a lot of the way the institution works is intended to promote that view. So they wear black robes, right? They shed their own personalities when they enter the courtroom, and they don a neutral personality of the black robe where they're all the same. There are no cameras in the courtroom. This is supposed to be a serious academic exercise. When people are arguing before the court, they are arguing the law. The justices are responding. They're asking questions about the law. This is not political media. This is not supposed to be political debate. This is supposed to be learned lawyers and judges discussing what the law means. And so they've been quite adamant about not having any kind of publicity and cameras in the courtroom and controlling the way the media interacts with the judges. In addition, their deliberations are secret. When they deliberate, only the nine of them are in that room where they have their conferences and decide their cases and discuss what they think. That means that if someone knocks on the door, the most junior justice is the one who has to get up and open the door. There's no one there but them. Now, that's not to say they work entirely in a vacuum. Each justice has several law clerks who they hire out of law school. Those law students are among the best and the brightest law students. They often, nowadays, always, although it didn't always used to be the case, clerk for a lower court judge before they come to the Supreme Court. And they help the justices research the cases. They help them write the opinions. They help them think about what questions they want to ask of the lawyers in the oral arguments. And one of the things that the clerks do that I think is particularly invisible to the public is they help the justices decide which cases even to hear. The justices get on the order of 10,000 petitions a year for cases. Many of those are unpaid petitions. They're called unpaid petitions. They're brought by people who can't afford to print 18 different copies of the briefs and the appendices and all those things, and the court hears those petitions, and they take very few cases. Of those 10,000 cases, they hear 70 to 80 a year. It's a tiny drop in the bucket. And the clerks are the ones who make a first pass at those 10,000 petitions and recommend whether they should take the case and what the issues are in the case and how the case should go. So the clerks play a really important role in the choosing of the cases, I think even more so than in the deciding of the case. I think the justices know their minds often. They know the law better than these recent law graduates on a regular basis. But the clerks are important in a huge way for the choosing of the cases. And then they're also important because they're the sounding boards for the justices. The justices' deliberations are private. They're not supposed to talk about these cases in public. And so the people that they talk to are their clerks.
The justices have significant autonomy to structure their chambers how they want to. This is true of all federal judges, by the way. Judges are responsible for hiring their own clerks, for hiring their own secretaries, and really for distributing the work among them however they want to. Different judges will want their clerks to do different things for them, and that's also true of the justices. So they really are sort of able to structure their chambers however they see fit.
Until President Ronald Reagan nominated Sandra Day O'Connor to the court, the justices of the Supreme Court had always been men. Until John F. Kennedy nominated Thurgood Marshall to the court, they had always been white. So for 200 odd years, the justice of the court had been unbelievably homogeneous. Now we are more racially diverse. We are more diverse in terms of the gender makeup of the court, but it's still a very homogeneous court. These are folks who are incredibly elite. They have largely gone to elite law schools. They have had very elite careers. And that wasn't always the case. There used to be more, actually, heterogeneity in terms of the socioeconomic backgrounds of the justices. They were often more self-taught, and their backgrounds looked more different than they do from one another today. One of the oddities of the process now is we live in a mostly Protestant country, and yet the justices are all either Catholic or Jewish. when you look at who sits on the court, you don't get the feeling that they're really representative of the people. And they're not actually meant to be, right? That's not how the nomination process works. That's not how the appointments process works. The president nominates and Congress, the Senate gets to confirm. And the question is, well, what do you look for in a Supreme Court justice? What makes a good Supreme Court justice? And I think a lot of people would say, obviously, the court needs to represent the people if they're going to tell us what the Constitution means, if they're going to have the power to strike down legislation passed by our states or by the national government. But I think there are real questions about that, right? If they really are doing law, you want to make sure they do it well. Now, I don't think that means they have to come from elite schools. I don't think that means they have to look the way they look now. But I think there has always been and continues to be a tension between our desire that the court be democratic and our desire that the court be precisely non-democratic, that the reason we have the court is to tie ourselves to the mast of the Constitution and have the court sit in judgment and say, you've gone off the rails now. You, the democracy, have gone off the rails. We are not part of that. They haven't always succeeded, as we see in Korematsu, right? They haven't always succeeded, as we see in Dred Scott. But I think that's what they often conceive of their role as. And yet, we are a democracy, and we think that the people, through their representative bodies, should make law. And the court doesn't do that, right? So I think there's this enduring tension about who the justices should be and what role the court should be playing.